We need to build strong bridges from the harm reduction policy world to the lives of families facing addiction, meeting those who use substances where they are. There is substantially more to the explanation of the overdose crisis than bad choices made by those in the throes of addiction. Understanding the larger systemic picture is key to understanding how to fix the problem. And of course, the kinds of roles the government and private partnerships can play in developing solutions. That is from my guest today, Patricia Roos, Professor Emerita of Sociology at Rutgers University, who devoted her career to the study of inequalities, work, gender, family dynamics, and addiction. She has published many books in her career and taught many classes at Rutgers. She served as the chair of the sociology department and the dean for social and behavioral sciences. She has been involved in many important projects. In 2020, in July, she retired, and she released a book in May of 2024 on Rutgers University Press titled Surviving Alex, A Mother's Story of Love, Loss, and Addiction. This is her story of grief and resilience, because in 2015, her 25-year-old son, Alex, died of a heroin overdose. Turning her grief into action, Patricia Roos began to research the social factors and institutional failures that contributed to his death. Surviving Alex tells her moving story and outlines the possibilities of a compassionate and effective approach to addiction treatment and policy. Weaving together a personal narrative and a sociological perspective, Surviving Alex movingly describes how children from good families fall prey to addiction and recounts the hellish toll it takes on families. She interviews many family members, therapists, teachers, police officers, she brings up files from his stays in hospitals, rehab facilities, and jail. And she paints a compelling picture of a young man whose life veered between happiness, anxiety, success, and despair. As she explores how a punitive system failed her son, she calls for a community of action that would improve care for substance users and reduce addiction, realigning public health policy to address the overdose crisis. All right, let's get to the interview. Hello, and welcome to the Intentional Clinician Podcast, where I will be speaking today with Patricia Roos. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Well, thanks for inviting me.
Yes, it's my pleasure. And today we're going to be talking about your story, and your story has been put into a book, Surviving Alex, A Mother's Story of Love, Loss, and Addiction. And in your book, you discuss your story about your son and the tragic factors that led up to his passing. Could you tell us, just because we're going to be talking about addiction, we're going to be talking about all these things, grief, we're going to be talking about how parents and loved ones can get resources, we're going to be talking a bit about our pet peeves with the current systems in place that are, you know, supposed to respond to drug and alcohol issues, and also, you know, the criminal justice system. But before we get into any of that, can you just tell us a little bit about your story of Alex, and in whatever way you want to, wherever you want to start?
Sure. Alex was just a delight. I was born in 1989, and he was just the funniest guy. He was an athlete. He was smart. He graduated from college with a degree in biology and a minor in computer science, and even a special honors in Latin. You know, he had a lot of breadth. He was, wickedly, well, I always describe him as wickedly funny, which he takes after his father, not for me. I'm not the funny sort, but he takes after his father in that regard. And he just was absolutely delightful. And then when he hit around 12 years old, he developed anorexia. And, you know, as we'll talk about with addiction, this is very much self-medicating, right? Mm-hmm. Issues such as anxiety really end up controlling his life at that point. It began, he thought he was fat, chubby at least, and no one would look at him. He was very much the athlete. No one would look at him and see him as being overweight by an ounce. And so, but that's what self-perception is, and that's what is really important, because if you perceive yourself in a way, then you are that. So he developed anorexia when he was 12. He was hospitalized in an eating disorder unit from 12 to 13. He spent Thanksgiving and Christmas and his birthday, and was there for weeks, and then partial treatment for weeks more, and then months more of therapy, a nutritional therapy, psychological therapy. And we thought we had dodged the bullet. It was just, he gained weight back when he went into the hospital. He was about 75, he weighed 68 pounds, and was about 75% of where he should have been at that point in time. He gained weight back. Started looking good. He came back into his middle school, 7th grade at that point. That's when he developed it. Wow, he started eating McDonald's and Dunkin' Donuts and things he would never touch before. But what we didn't know, shortly thereafter, he started drinking. We didn't know about that until later. And then in high school, he started drinking more. And in college, that's what kids do when they were in college. They take risks. He started to use drugs at that point, certainly marijuana, but mushrooms and oxy and those kind of things, illegal oxy, illicit oxy. But he graduated on time. We thought, whoa, he's doing well. So we kept hoping that he'd age out. And then after he graduated, we had that summer was really a terrible summer for us. We call it the summer from hell, the summer of 2012, when he graduated in May. And then within a month, his grandmother died, who he had been extremely close with. And then 6 weeks later, his uncle, who lived in the same town as us, had died. And Hal's wife had died 8 years earlier. So their children, young teenagers at the time, came to live with us. And so that kind of threw Alex for a loop, because he said, he'd always been the only child, and now he loved those kids. I mean, they were like his, brother and sister, but how brothers and sisters are. They can
Oh,
be
yeah.
really difficult to deal with. So he was feeling like, oh my, I have this responsibility. I got to take care of these kids now that they're living in my house. And so those kind of feelings. But within a year, he really got into the hard drugs. By 2013, maybe we think end of that summer, certainly by the fall, he was injecting heroin. Fentanyl wasn't here yet, at least in his world. That was when it became very terrifying. And I describe it as the, well, anybody in who knows the literature for addiction knows that people use the term insanity. And the insanity, we just lived in that insanity on a daily basis. I also call it the carousel ride from hell, because once you're in it, it just seems to go round and round and round, and you go from rehab to rehab. He went to 12 different rehabs, and he died in May of 2012. Very, very sad for us. We just were brokenhearted. At that point, we just had to pick up and go on as a family and sort of redefine what family means. So that's the story, the shorthand story.
Yes, and a very it's almost like the last when he got in his addiction became escalated. That was like just it happened kind of quickly according to the timeline I'm hearing.
Well, I mean, it had been leading up from high school, drinking marijuana, those kind of drugs that a lot of kids that age, frankly, get into and then age out of. And Of course, if you think about it as self-medicating, which I do, right? I think about
Right.
taking any drugs along this way. You're doing it for a purpose, right? You're doing
Right.
it to medicate yourself, not because you're choosing to do it, but because you're self-medicating. So if you think about it as self-medicating, it actually has a very long history, because if you think about his anorexia as being part of the same process, he was self-medicating then and he was self-medicating. So it came quickly into the when it really got very bad, when he started going to rehabs. And
Yes.
I know I've talked with parents whose kids who've been in this process for 18 years, and Alex had sort of an active addiction of about 3 years, I'd say, when he really got into the really when it was really insanity for us.
Yeah. I'm so sorry that that all happened. I'm glad that you're telling your story. The situation, if you've read the research, just for parents, like when, just for parents listening, if somebody gets involved in drugs and alcohol younger, nicotine, alcohol, marijuana are the usuals, it's harder for them to break out of the cycle of addiction because it is self-medicating. It is, even if it starts out like an experiment, like a lot, some kids will just do it at a party or something. If they start doing it regularly, that is self-medicating. And yes, is there an addiction component? Absolutely, because there's a biological component. But a lot of kids do it because it helps them feel better, it helps them deal with stress. It's fun at first, and then it becomes the habit. And with Alex, it was he started young and kind of hid it. Obviously, most kids are hiding it. Obviously, he was hiding it from you, and then it got really bad and into the spiral. So
You
I
can't
think
hide it. Gets to a
no.
point where you can't hide it.
Absolutely not. And you could see it in his behavior and everything going on. And I think it's important for the entire conversation around substance use for people to be understand it as a mental health correlated condition and a medical condition.
Yes.
Because a lot of people get angry and they kind of have these kind of binary black and white discussions about, oh, well, they were just doing this and all of that. And yes, there's choice involved, but at a certain point, you lose control. And if you've talked to anybody who's survived it, like the some old timers that have kind of survived heroin or survived cocaine, they'll tell you that they feel like they've lost control and made horrible decisions when they were using drugs. They got arrested multiple times. And so your brain ends up, you end up being almost like a different person when you're using and when you're craving, when you get to the harder and harder drugs. So I think it's important for people listening to understand this is a multifaceted situation, and there are solutions, but they're not just easy solutions, right? And every person who's been affected by alcohol and drugs and addiction has a little bit of their own path, right? Because
Yes.
like we say in mental health, the outer layer is the alcohol and drugs. The inner layer is what's going on inside of that person's mind and how they're perceiving their life and why the need was there to start, right? And that's pretty hard to get to because some people they'll tell you right away, oh, it's this, right? But a lot of people they're not even sure themselves why they started, right? They're not quite sure. So any thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, actually, I think that this is really what I often talk about as being the central puzzle of what I deal with in the book, which is that our conventional explanations, I think, they just don't work. And if you think about the one that we always hear about, and not so much in the research world or in the world of addiction policy that you were in, is that conventional explanation of people choose drugs, right? They just choose to do it. And we don't think about that as being true anymore, but a lot of people do, and the public certainly out there, the great American public definitely thinks that the case. And then we kind of shifted to this idea of a brain disease, right? Which was, somewhat better, right? Because it medicalized it in a way. And it got at this idea of compulsion that, once you take that first hit, you have this compulsion to continue. And I think the data seem to suggest, anyway, as far as I know it, is that only 10% of those who actually take drugs become addicted. So there's a difference there, which is very distinct, which says some people, lots of people take drugs, right? But only some of them become addicted. So what is it that leads to that addiction? And so, and I think those are kind of satisfying answers to a lot of people, because we say, oh my gosh, they're quote addicts, end quote. And well, let's take that addict and put that addict in jail, and let's shun them and shun their families. And if we keep them out of sight, then they're out of mind, right? But I think what it doesn't deal with, and this is what I really try to say in my book, is that we need more nuance. We need much, much more complexity, because we need to take into account, and this is where the sort of sociologist in me comes out, we need to take into account context, right? It's not that individual choice doesn't occur, right? Of course it does. But that individual choice occurs within a larger context, right? So context is really the clue here. And it gets at all those kind of systemic, or what sociologists call systemic or structural factors, right, that exists out there, such as, I'm sure we'll talk about, the criminal justice system, right? That exists out there. And so we need to take into account that context in order to understand it, and to understand that self-medication is why people are making the choices that they do, in large measure, not entirely, but in large measure, people are self-medicating because they need that, whatever it is. They need it to deal with the psychology, the anxiety, the depression, or they need it to deal with, if you think, take into account socioeconomic factors like, the issues of poverty, unemployment, racism, right? Incarceration, right? These are factors that exist out there that then help us to understand why somebody would feel that need to self-medicate.
Right. With stress, we see self-medicating going up. I mean, that's just the easiest. That's actually, I think, a correlation that you can say. I mean, we saw during the pandemic when people were stressed out, they drank and used more marijuana than ever.
Right. Right.
And you're right. A lot of people, it seems to be after age 30, there's like this kind of why with some people that have been using throughout their 20s, like alcohol and marijuana, we'll say, and they sort of fall off. It kind of diminishes because life responsibilities, and clearly they didn't have that kind of addiction that was the compulsion to continue to use or the need. But like you said, like poverty, for instance, if I'm in a stressful neighborhood and I don't know how to calm my nerves and I have an apartment, that's nice. But if you've ever lived in a difficult neighborhood, I have, it's loud. You know, the walls, they aren't the nicest apartment complexes. The walls are thin. It's hard to get peace. So the nervous system is constantly overstimulated. There's not many nice parks around. And a lot of people medicate by, electronic devices. That's what everyone in America does now. But then to sleep or to cope, people will drink or use drugs or whatever. And it becomes, as you know, sociologically, what are your neighbors doing? What are your friends doing? They have influence over you.
Peers, right?
Peers, right.
Yeah.
Exactly. And the peer pressure does not stop when you're an adult. So there's a lot of things going on that the system is not built to understand what we now know from science. The paradigm of science has shifted into understanding it as a multifaceted medical issue with sociological and narrative and personal choice components, absolutely, but also now understanding it I would call it an adult way of understanding it. I think our country in general is still coming out of sort of an adolescent black and white teenage viewpoint of a lot of serious issues.
Good way to think about it.
So the way I see it is that our country used to think, okay, there's good guys and there's bad guys, right? And we're the good guys and the criminals are the bad guys and we got to lock them all up, right? I won't go into the genocide from the 1800s or 1700s where it was the other people were the bad guys, we were the good guys. But anyway, the mindset of that then is taught in schools to an extent. I think it's kind of getting, that's kind of stopping, right? We're getting into more nuanced conversations in the last 20 years from my anecdotal evidence. But if you look into a lot of the criminal justice systems, and I've worked with lots of people on probation and parole, and I've been to their courtrooms, and I've worked with the parole and probation officers, there was a good segment, a small segment of probation and parole officers who really understood this. And they were oftentimes the most popular ones. And a lot of their people on their caseloads were getting better and getting out of the system, the whole point of it. But right. There were a lot, and I would say the majority that I met, who used punitive methods and authoritarian language because they thought the only way that people will learn is if you drill into their heads that they've been a bad boy or girl or whatever, or they, and that you've done this bad stuff and you've got to pay the penalty and this sort of thing. And what we know from psychology is that when you start labeling somebody in this way, especially someone under the age of 30, because the prefrontal cortex research is now showing that males actually don't really get their full development until late 20s.
Wow.
And females are around 24, 25.
Right.
So
interesting.
So that's a new article that just came out in the last year. So with that, young people start to develop an identity that goes along with the drug and substance use issue they're dealing with, if they're in the criminal justice system or caught up in any sort of, or poverty or make some mistakes or have a financial difficulty, that somehow they're bad, which then just right there, if I have that identity, why would I take care of myself? Why not just use more drugs and alcohol? And so that's that. And so we see that the system is not built to handle it. We have to be able to, we'll get into that, but we have, because I want to ask about Alex's encounters with these systems, both medical and criminal justice system. A lot of the hospitals and intensive outpatient programs still have this old viewpoint that is just kind of like, you're either working on your recovery or you're not working on your recovery, right? And yeah, is that true? No. Some days you're going to work on it, some days you're not, right?
Please, I mean, ask me about the medical system as well.
Yes. Okay, we'll ask. Well, let's go.
Put that on your list.
I'm putting it on my list. Yeah, so we'll go medical.
I have very strong opinions about that.
We'll go to, let's go to the criminal justice system first, because he did have some run-ins with that. Can you tell us just, you don't have to go into the detail of the story unless you want to, but just more or less like how you feel he was treated and kind of what happened around that. I know that he had a marijuana charge, which I think is the biggest one that's a stark, obvious thing to me, because our whole system has changed since this all happened. But anyway, let's go with you on
He started having run-ins with EMS and, just in general, sort of getting into combat with authority figures, right, which really started in high school, but really went really bad in college. And his very first semester, he ended up getting picked up for underage drinking. And he's mouthing off at some local guy, and they arrested him. And so, at that point, college is kind of a consequence-free zone, right? In the sense that you can do these kind of things and you can kind of get away with it. And they just eliminate any kind of discussion of this in his record. It just disappears. The colleges that he went to just got rid of it. When he graduated, they got rid of it. So, but it really, he was out at Penn State at one point and got drunk, and he tried to get into a fraternity party and the guy didn't like it, and the bouncer hit him in the face and knocked out his front tooth. And, so that was kind of typical of the things that happened. And, it was like a blinking red light to us, like, oh my God, he's really going off the deep end here. But we were lulled into the fact that he was doing so well in school. He had like an A-minus average and doing well in a biology major. And so, we thought, okay, hopefully he'll grow out of it, right? He'll age out of it. But then when he graduated, he ended up with that summer, not the first summer. The first summer of hell was pretty horrible. But it was really the next summer when he It was the end of 2012. I take it back, where he got a DUI. It wasn't actually adjudicated until a year later when he lost his driver's license, I think for 6 months. But the non-criminal justice pieces of it are just as bad because they're really expensive. I mean, you have to every year $1,000 extra and money going out here and money going out there. So it's really, but it's also that labeling that you were talking about, creating this label of you're the person who is, a criminal in some sense. And yes, so he got arrested at one point for marijuana possession. And that just hounded him for the rest of his life, because if you're in rehab and they come after you and you have to come into into some kind of court hearing and you're not there, so then they send out a warrant for your arrest. And the here's where the kind of broader structural issues come to bear, right? Because in New Jersey, when he was arrested, right, it was illegal to have, possess marijuana. But within a couple of years, it was totally decriminalized. So, what kind of an impact does that have, right? Here's a young man who was arrested, and a couple of years later, it wasn't even illegal, right? It was totally decriminalized and signed into by Governor Phil Murphy, and that is great for all the people who came after Alex, but for him, that was really the thing. It was really, I mean, I look at everything that he wrote along, in the various rehabs. He had lengthy statements that he made about his, they do that in rehabs. He had was 12 of them, as I mentioned. But in one in particular, he wrote these lengthy essays about how did he get to where he was? He constantly, for the rest of his life, saw that it was too late for him, especially once he had been arrested. Later, he was arrested for heroin possession. And so once he was arrested, he felt like he had no life left. He felt that it was just impossible for him to succeed. And he had this really, strong goal to be a success in life. And he saw this drug taking, the substance use that was so had taken over his life. He saw that it had so much taken over his life that it was too late. And he had three different suicide notes, and each one of them said the same thing: it's too late, I can't get out from under this. And it was all related to the effects of the criminal justice system on his opportunity to even get a job, right? We know if once you get arrested, or certainly if you go to jail, right, you have to check that box, and that means that you are unable to get a job. People just say, "Oh no, we're not going to hire you here because you have criminal justice experience." But I think taking into account those kind of broader factors, those systemic factors, I think is really critically important. And just talking about it as choice doesn't take that into account, because he felt he had no choice. And he told us on more than one occasion, "Do you think I like this life? Do you think I want this life?" No, of course he didn't. And we had to make choices within these constraints as well. And so that affected our ability to make choices that were the best choices for him.
Yes, this is a tragic, unfortunately, often told story of parents who and children who are and young adults who are going through this and get caught up in the system because obviously, using drugs and alcohol are going to probably, to a, in an in a way where it's often habitual, often leads to behavior, which can, you know, be disruptive, or something happens, or you get in trouble for possession. So I think...
Could I add one more thing to that, yeah. which I think follows up on what you just said, which is that we tend to think that people who do this, who make these, quote, choices, end quote, are others, right? We other them in a way. And this is one of the reasons why I wanted to write this book, was because people don't think it can happen to, you know, middle-class suburban families. And I say, come take a look at it. This is our family. We had a good family. We had a normal family, right? Just those sitting out in the backyard kind of family, and kids running around in the backyard, right? It was totally normal that anybody can relate to. And I always say that, you know, if it can happen to my family, it can happen to yours. And people don't think that's the case, because they like to other people. They like to think, oh, something was wrong here. Maybe the parents, usually the mother's held responsible, right? Mother did something wrong. No, this is like, read it. I talk about it in excruciating detail in the book. Like, here's what it's like to live through this insanity. Yeah, sorry, I interrupted you.
Oh, no, that's fine. I was make a point. I'm going to make a point about family before I go to the criminal justice reform. But I would say this for listeners of the show, you can actually go back and search the word addiction or drugs, and you will find multiple other interviews with parents from upper middle class backgrounds and very highly successful people that I've interviewed, where their sons and daughters were on drugs and went through horrific things. So one thing I'll say to that, just to break it from my perspective, is this: for the families out there, I'm going to go systems, and I'm going to go parents. So the first is this: there are hundreds of substance abuse rehab centers around the United States. Possibly thousands. I don't know. They're all over the place. Search substance abuse rehab center. You'll see tons of them with advertising and brochures to bring your kids to a sober living, bring them to this inpatient facility, and do all this stuff. I'm going to say right now that almost none of those facilities that are popular on the internet take public health insurance. They do not take Medicaid health insurance, which means that these are filled with people who are from the middle class or up, who can afford private health insurance or cash payments for their kids. And these are full of people all the time, not only 18 to 25 year olds that we were kind of discussing and teenagers, but full on adults. And yes, are there substance use centers that do take Medicaid? Yes, they're usually awfully funded and not a great place to go. But that is not the majority of them. And what I'll say this is, drugs and alcohol don't care what neighborhood you grew up in. They don't care what socioeconomic status. They don't care what your religion is or non-religion or your political leanings. It is everywhere. And especially these days, kids there's so much access to drugs and alcohol like there's never been. First of all, we could go off on this, but we won't. Synthetics. I could order synthetics on the internet right now. You can go to a store and get kratom, which I think should be totally regulated or outlawed, which is a very addictive substance that can lead to, it helps with anxiety temporarily, but it's very super addicting. You can buy that right down the street. People are buying vapes online with their parents' credit cards, using their parents' names, getting them shipped to their house for nicotine and marijuana. Well, not marijuana, but nicotine. Marijuana is legal, which I'm in favor of, but I also think there's a lot of safety risks because of that for parents of teenagers. And I'm in favor of it because of the legal implications and the fact that, you know, depends how you use a drug, right? It's not the drug that's bad. It's how you use it. The hard part is, for some people, using it the same as another person leads to a lifelong addiction because of their biology and these epigenetics that we're still sort of uncovering. Plus, life story. So I work, I'm a clinical director of a counseling agency, and we are in the middle between a city and the suburbs, and it does not matter. We get the same issues on both sides. It's just different cultures coming in to the center, with teenagers, young adults, all having these issues. We're in a drug culture. People are busier than ever. So economically, parents, whether you're even, you know, whether you're blue collar and, you know, the lower economic status or middle and upper class, I see parents have been busier than ever. So keeping an eye on this, which isn't your total responsibility, but partly, is incredibly difficult because people are trying to make their economic goals work. And so there's a lot to be said that anyone who's, you know, parenting at any point needs to be educated on this and know the signs of substance use, because most teenagers are real. I mean, especially your son was very intelligent, but these kids are smart. They learn from each other how to hide it, right? And the longer they do it without intervention before 18, the worse percentage outcome you're going to get when you're a young adult. And as you know, in university settings, now a lot of universities are starting, I'm very proud to say, they're making wellness centers. They're working really hard at getting more mental health counselors on campuses, which is awesome. But traditionally, especially even just 15 years ago, what are schools known as? Party schools. There's a ranking of party schools. And there are seriously people that kids are like, I want to go to this school because it's a party school. I've literally heard this. What does that mean? Drinking, right? Drinking. So what I mean is, to parents, it doesn't matter where you're at and what you believe. It's a matter of behavior and what's accessible. And your kid is going to think differently than you, even if they share the same values. So important to watch for that. There's whole books on that. Definitely read your book. And there's all sorts of books for parents on like how to watch for the signs. But with Alex, you know, being the interesting thing about him was that he maintained. He got through high school, he got through college, he got good grades, he clearly was articulate. And so you might in a way, if I had met him, I would think, oh well, gee, maybe he's gonna kind of overcome this, like, you know, he speaks so eloquently. But sometimes when I've worked with people his age, that actually the most intelligent ones are the most difficult ones to deal with, because they're so, I don't know how to explain it, so intelligent that they almost like trick, you know, it's almost like a trick when they relapse. It's like I don't know how to explain it, but
they live in their head.
Yeah. Thank you. They live in their head. And somehow and when they relapse, it's harder because then the biology kicks in again. And then that's so hard to shake. So with that, the whole idea we're talking about is that this is a medical issue. It's a sociological issue. It is a brain disorder. It is also, you know, something that is in our culture. It's everywhere. It's in the rich communities, the poor communities, in more than ever. But we know this. The marijuana is more strong. There's more alcohol drinks than there's ever been, you know, different ways to get introduced to it. So that being said, the criminal justice system, I think, is somewhere between 100 and 200 years out of date to catch up with science. And I'm not sure how to reform that. But if I was going to propose some reforms, one of the reforms I saw in Phoenix was this. One of the courts dedicated itself to called drug court. Have you heard of drug court?
Yeah, I have. Sometimes drug courts can work well, but it depends how they're operated.
Like, exactly. Right.
Are they connected only to 12-step programs? Then they're not good.
Right.
If they allow other kinds of strategies, then there's hope for them. New Jersey calls them recovery coaches.
Oh, I like that better. Well, that's the whole idea, is how do we, when somebody's out of control, like with a psychiatric condition, they're suicidal, they're homicidal, we take away their freedom temporarily in a hospital or whatever until they are able to be stabilized so that they can start their road to recovery. We give them more autonomy. And the same, unfortunately, might have to be applied in some cases with drugs, except the issue is, instead of a criminal sentence, it should be a rehab or some sort of recovery coach or some sort of mandated therapies, instead of putting them behind bars, especially the nonviolent offenders, which is most drug clients. I can't say this, I don't have the data in front of me, but from my understanding, are not always, they're like, mostly if the drugs is the main issue, they're nonviolent, right? If drugs is a secondary issue and they were violent, there might've been drugs involved.
Yeah.
So why aren't we treating them like these are fellow Americans that have had problems? Clearly, that's why they're in this criminal justice system. Right. How do we reform and help them to recover instead of get punished because that fulfills our fantasy of the good guy and the bad guy motif. And we're so disgusted at their drug use and we're so ashamed of it. No, this is a problem. These people need help and they need a different type of sentencing. The sentencing should be something like rehab, to having to go to social worker, having to have a therapist, working on why they use drugs in the first place, and including, obviously somehow restraining them from using so that their brain can recover and not be biologically dependent. Those are my thoughts. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, no, I think that sounds good. I think we need to take the criminal justice system out of it entirely.
Oh, yeah.
I just don't think... I think we need to reconceptualize our definitions here. And what we need to think about is that this is a public health and a public health issue. It should be treated as a public health issue, not as a criminal justice issue, because as soon as you make it a criminal justice issue, then you are really, and Alex is such a great example of this, right? You are creating a kind of history there that negatively affects people's ability to get jobs. And if we think about drug use as something that people age out of, and the data certainly seem to suggest that, by the age of, by 37, 75% of the people with severe substance use problems have no symptoms whatsoever. Mm-hmm. And here you have Alex as a 25-year-old, right? He's got a lot, those 12 years, that he could have done something really good. But because of the criminal justice sanctions that he lived with on a daily basis, he didn't have that opportunity. So, I have the end of my book, I have this counterfactual, which is something that historians love, right? What would it be? How would the world differ if we had had, if JFK had not been killed, or if Hillary Clinton had won the 2016 election, right? You can go back and you can say, okay, what would that counterfactual world look like? And so I do this kind of counterfactual that says, what would it look like if we had lived in a compassionate harm reduction world, as opposed to the punitive criminal justice system that we lived in? And I think, that Alex would have had a chance to age out and do well. He had lots of friends. When I interview them, one of the things I do in my book is I interview a lot of Alex's friends. I interview police officers. I interview anybody, teachers, right? Anybody who would talk with me. I interviewed them because I wanted to understand, right? How could this happen to my family? And, I think at the end of the day, the criminal justice system became a real, if you want to talk about a bad guy, the criminal justice system became a bad guy in our story. And that wasn't always the case. Sometimes when Alex first overdosed, the local police were good about the way they treated it, right? They were compassionate. But it's when you don't know them. It's like when the police arrest you because, you have a warrant out for your arrest and they hold you in jail. And, it's like you're a scum of the earth, right? And so that's what destroys people's, ability to have a future, to think that they have a future. So, so I totally agree with you that the criminal justice system, that is number one on my list of priorities, that we need to rethink how we do criminal justice with respect to addiction in this country. And we need to think about it as a public health. And I've been doing a lot of op-eds recently, and that's the way that I try to approach it is, this is the way that we need to think about it moving forward. But people have a hard idea. I mean, most people I talked with had not heard the term harm reduction at all.
Okay.
And people who are in that business, right, they know it and they know how vibrant it has become, right? And as you mentioned, in certain states, it's become very well-known and successful. But I would say 95% of the people that I interviewed had not a clue about what harm reduction is. So that's one of the things that I try to do in the book is talk about harm reduction as a way of thinking about how to deal with addiction, an alternative approach rather than the kind of punitive approach. And I think what really needs to be done is that you need to link the practitioners, the people who do know what harm reduction is, link them to the people like us, you know, a decade ago who had no idea. You know, I mean, I'm smart. I'm a professor. I knew how to do research, and I could not find anything other than 12-step programs. And that's where he did. That's where he was. So we have come very far, I think, in a lot of ways. But I still think they're most, I would venture to say, most families that are in the situation that we were 10 years ago, and they're in it now, they are being bombarded with lots of information that they don't understand and how to deal with it. And there's not enough of a connection to the harm reduction community. But there's such good stuff going on, and there's such good support services going on that didn't exist 10 years ago, you know, like online, really terrific online support groups that are so much better than they were 10 years ago. So, you know, I think we've been moving in the right direction. You know, I have one op-ed that I'm working on now that asks, you know, that tries to identify how have things changed. And I had a hard time thinking about it in the beginning because I thought, oh, it's just as bad as it used to be. But when you think about it, there are a whole set of things that have happened. And one of them is this growth in the harm reduction movement. But I still think we need to better link them to people who are going through families are going through addiction.
Yeah, I agree completely. I mean, the harm reduction method is a long thing to talk about, but it's a way that helps the people that are dealing with substance use issues to actually engage in treatment. Because if you ask them immediately to quit drugs and alcohol and everything they're doing immediately, they're just going to walk right out because they're in the middle of addiction. Right. And if you don't know what that's like, I feel like the people that don't know what that's like are more likely to say you need to quit right now. But we know that doesn't work with cigarettes. We know that doesn't work. And that's why a lot of doctors have been trained in the techniques called motivational interviewing since the 1980s. Mm-hmm. That's been moving to help clients. It's called meet them where they're at, right? And you have
that's
to
harm
be
reduction.
Right. And you have to
meet them where they are.
Right. Make small little goals. Yeah. And that's how people change anyway, is small little goals. And it's got to be their idea. But a lot of people who have addiction, they are torn with ambivalence. One part of them wants to quit so badly.
Right.
But another part of them doesn't want to quit and they want to say, screw you. And then there's another part of them that says, well, I'm kind of dependent on this. I feel better when I'm on this, you know, and what happens if I'm off of it? And then like my fears come back. And so right there is indicative of, you know, narrative. It's indicative of mental health underneath or a biological issue going on underneath, you know, how, you know, a lot of people, you know, use drugs to sleep nowadays because they're so stressed out with their, you know, having all the electronic news at our fingertips all the time is one of the things, and the economic situation. So I think the psychology world has been changing. I've seen it change with more, we call it trauma informed, but really just, I would even say adverse experience informed, because with Alex, like you said, he couldn't identify trauma before the ages that he started getting arrested. That
was his trauma.
That was the trauma.
That was his trauma.
Right.
Yeah.
And so that right there is a trauma informed or an adverse experience informed perspective from a clinician can help not to other him in the treatment or other anyone in the treatment and make them feel beneath or like they're a bad person for using drugs. Like all this old school sort of judgment that I think comes from the mythology of the good guy, bad guy, but also from some religious aspects paint this as well. Like it's all like, it's either you're good or you're either you do it or you quit. And AA, so what I'll say is, I'll get into AA in a second, but the outpatient counseling world has improved in that. The hard part is because outpatient counseling is more independent practitioners or like a clinic, like the one I work at, everyone has their own autonomy, but the trainings that we all go to together are all the latest science, right? The feedback-informed treatment, the trauma-informed treatment coming out of the federal government's research, all the research is pointing this way, is this is the most effective treatment for substance use. However,
if you go back and look 10 years ago, right, it's just like there,
it wasn't
not,
there.
Not one of the
No.
12-step, not one of the, or let me say it this way, all of the programs that he went to, every single one of them was 12-step oriented. And if he didn't meet their expectations, he was out. They kicked him out. Multiple places kicked him out.
Which is horrible.
No, which is absolutely. And, you know, he was happy to be out. Let me be. Or he went through the program and 2 days later he relapsed again, right? And so obviously it didn't work. And there was no way they were meeting him where he was at. And I think this is what struck me, because I didn't know about this until I started writing the book after Alex had died, that this was even an approach. And I was totally taken by it, because it made so much sense to me to think about. You meet people where they are. You know, I've talked with some people or police officers, and they don't like the idea that, you know, that you would allow people to, you know, like go to overdose prevention sites, for example, or, you know, if people break the law, they should pay the price for breaking the law. You know, that's kind of the criminal justice kind of approach to it. And, you know, but I just think that if you reach people and you reach them in a, both combined with aging out, right? But if you reach them with, you know, a little bit at a time, right? A little bit, you know, let's do this. If we can make small gains, and that's what harm reduction is all about, right? So.
Yes, absolutely. And I'm going to comment on two things, the police officer and also what I have seen not change is the highly lucrative businesses of inpatient centers and hospitals.
Yeah.
They are very slow to change. I don't know why, but they're still doing a lot of these old methods that have been proven to not work. I mean, AA is this way. If you look at the research of AA of people getting quote unquote sober, it's dismal, but AA is a good resource for people that self-select into it. They're ready for that.
For some people.
And they're ready for that sort of approach. But a lot of the researchers said people under the age of 30 hate AA. They're developmentally not ready for it. Somebody going, all right, kid, you either in it or you're out of it. Yeah. That's not how kids think. That's not how most people think, but that's definitely not how kids think. It's like they're still developing their
definitely
identity.
Definitely not the way Alex thought.
No, you're developing your identity still, and drugs and alcohol are a part of your identity at that age. Yeah. So, and in terms of the law, like I understand the police officer saying, if you break the law, you got to pay the price. And I would say this. If you're dealing drugs, that's a crime, and that needs to be separated from the abuse, right? A DUI is a crime, and it needs to be separated from the drinking. It's that you drove a car while drinking. That was wrong, and that's a crime. And so both of those deserve some type of penalty in the system that is reasonable. The issue is this. If you possess drugs, use drugs, crack cocaine, heroin, methamphetamine, fentanyl, all of those things are quote unquote crimes in our system today. Even mushrooms is a crime, and marijuana in certain states. That is ridiculous to penalize people, because the only person they're hurting is themselves or their kid, if they have a child. So if they're hurting themselves, they need medical treatment, not punitive. And if they're hurting their kid, then we have to get child protective services involved, but that's still not criminal. Right. And that's, I think, what you're talking about, getting the system out of it. This should be a public health. We need to have a different department that addresses addiction. If we had a department that addressed addiction as a personal problem that everyone can get addicted. Like if people don't realize how addicted they are to different foods, people are very picky about their foods. They buy the same cookies. They buy the same sodas. I challenge anybody out there that really likes a brand of something that they eat frequently to just stop it cold turkey. Just stop eating cookies. Stop it. Stop eating sugar. Stop it. Stop drinking any soda. Don't have any alcohol. See how long it takes until you start craving it. Right? You like sandwiches? Okay. Stop eating sandwiches. All you can eat is salads for lunch for the next month and rice. You can't have sandwiches. Your body biologically habituates to certain materials and you crave them. Drugs are just way stronger. Right? Drugs and sugar are way stronger. Alcohol is way stronger. So if we had a department of public safety that worked with people who have addiction, now I know this would quote unquote cost money, right? But that's prevention versus the millions of dollars and lives that are lost from people dying, people being arrested, people going through the criminal justice system for drugs that they're taking for themselves. It doesn't make any sense.
I totally agree with you, with one sort of exception.
Sure, go for it. You're the. This is just me ad hocking. What's that?
No. I mean, what do they say about the kind of this is not data driven. This is all what sociologists call qualitative research.
Yes, qualitative. Right.
This is narrative form. This is memoir.
Anecdotal, right? In my opinion.
Well, it's not anecdotal.
Right. Oh,
yeah.
I see.
Kind of. Right. Yeah. But I think I want to make a distinction because most people who do low level drug use also sell. Right.
Mm-hmm.
So people think that when we have laws that go after, drug dealers and people talking about, we want to shoot drug dealers. I won't mention names.
Yeah, that's
but,
not good.
Certainly the head of the Philippines, right, was saying.
Oh,
that.
Yeah.
Explicitly. But even people in this country, that's their view of drug dealers, because when they hear drug dealers, they think of El Chapo, right?
Yes.
Or those two guys, that just gave themselves up the other week. But most people, most young people who do drugs, they buy drugs and then they divide it up and they give it to friends or they sell it to friends, and so those are not the kind of low-level drug users that we should be targeting, right? We should be targeting the real dealers. I mean, here's where I think the whole war on drugs has been a disaster, because what we've done is we've gone after, the people who, we talk about illicit drugs and we go after them. And we think about it as a supply side issue, right? We need to go after those drug dealers. We need to go after those, quote, immigrants who are bringing them across the border, which is, kind of ridiculous on the face of it, because most of the drugs that come in are brought in by U.S. citizens through regular ports of entry, right? Not through climbing over walls and bringing over huge packs of fentanyl. I mean, fentanyl,
right.
Is teeny tiny. It's very easy to bring fentanyl over the border.
Oh, yeah.
So, we think about it in terms of supply, and what we really need to talk about is demand, right? Certainly we don't want the Mexican cartels to be bringing drugs across our border. Everybody, we can all agree on that, right? But let's talk about the demand, right? There has always been a demand for drugs, regardless of the kind of drugs we're talking about. There will always be a demand for drugs. The type of drug varies over time, right? When Alex was doing injection, right, he was injecting heroin. Nowadays, it's fentanyl. It's moving on to, drug names I can't even talk about. The X one.
Mm.
I mean, I, there's so many of them available through veterinary medicine, and people are, it does horrific things to you. So, there will always be demand. So we have to attack that demand, and how best to attack it. Do we attack it in a way that says, we're going to throw you all in jail? Or do we attack it in a way that says, let's try to bring you to health, not throwing you in jail, bring you to health so that you're healthy again and you can join society? You have to do that with families, not separate from families. For all the rehabs Alex was in, they didn't want to hear from us for the most part. They would talk with us once, but they thought we were getting in the way of them dealing with their important psychology, psychological therapy, which there wasn't much psychological therapy going on anyway. So anyway, I think my point here is that we're thinking about it all wrong. And so I think it's consistent with what you're saying. I don't think it's.
Yeah.
I don't think
and what
it's
I meant by
what you're saying.
I agree with you completely. I think for low level dealing, I don't think that's still a public health issue. That's just that's just the friends they're doing what they're always doing. If it would just think about the legalities. It's the same as going to a bar and getting your friend shots. All the college kids are sharing their Adderall. And some of them are sharing opiates and other things, but it's not a operation. You're talking about El Chapo. Yes, the people that are
that's
importing.
A good distinction.
Right. The people that are importing in an operated crime manner, that's a whole nother topic. And of course, we should go after that. But that's everyone. I won't even go into politics, but it is such a joke that we say it's all these immigrants. It is not. There are plenty of full-blooded Americans that have been here their entire lives that are dealing a high-level operations of drugs and importing in ways that are very sophisticated and run like a business. So
yes,
should we go after them? Of course, but that is a different division. And that's what I've said. Police need to be broken up into different divisions. That's a whole division. Mm-hmm. Drug enforcement, that's the high side dealer side. Sure, we should, of course, but you said there always will be a demand. So it's kind of a losing battle, but should we stop it if we can? Yes. But what's going to be more effective is treatment and figuring out how to treat and bring people back into society. And especially young people, teenagers into middle 20s, they are still not mature enough to always make the best choices for themselves, and they need more guidance, regardless of their family, right? And so that being said, if our country wanted to really invest some money, obviously education, I think we should invest more money into education, but diversifying our education and really bringing mental health and drug education into schools in a way that's not just a scare tactic, right? That's more of an information knowledge section. And as I said, I've been applauding some of the universities that have been bringing in these new health centers. They're bringing in more therapists. They're bringing in more drug education, alcohol education. That is awesome. Having more free activities on campus that don't involve alcohol and drugs. But when people get caught up in, quote, any system, the answer should be, how do we rehabilitate this individual versus how do we make them a, quote, example? I have never... I've met people that have been arrested and gone to jail so many times. I've never had one of them say, wow, I read in the news that so-and-so got sentenced to 5 years, and that really made me think about my actions. They aren't reading that news. No. They don't care. You're a child. You're a young person. You think I'm invincible. That's the ego. I'll never get caught. I'll never be in trouble. I'll never have something bad happen to me. So we're applying the logic of people 30 and up who aren't on substance uses and haven't had the experience of loved ones or going through it themselves to a population that it doesn't apply to. Mm-hmm. And so I think, we're on the same page. There's a lot that needs to be reformed from the medical system, especially the bigger hospitals and rehabs, to the courts, to whatever we call public safety, public health, a lot of investment there. I mean, the opiate epidemic was just crazy. I couldn't believe, you know, everything I've read about that. And you can read about the Sackler family if people want to know about business. Why is the Sackler family different than El Chapo? Just because they had guns in El Chapo and shot people. The Sackler family took marketing and said that this was safe, and people got addicted to it and died within a year or two of being on these opiates. So I don't see the difference, except that one is doing it, quote, in a legal way, and one is, quote, doing it in an illegal way. Mm-hmm. So that being said, I want to talk about some positive treatments that you've come across or resources for families who are going through what you went through.
Yeah. So we've talked about treatment, but we haven't spent that much time talking about, well, we did spend some time talking about how bad the treatment is, but I think
positive treatments.
But if there is more positive treatment, like things oriented around harm reduction, for example, but most of the treatment programs out there, I just saw an article by Maya Solovitz in the New York Times that gave a figure of a third, I think, if I remember correctly, of treatment programs use medicine. So MAT, medication-assisted treatment, or mood, medications for opioid use disorder, or methadone, right? That there are medications that science has now found help people to get off of drugs, right? Especially opioids. in particular. And so why aren't they available? That only a third of treatment, I mean, Alex was in 12 of them, as I mentioned, not one. They were all 12 step. Not one had any medications except maybe a little bit of Suboxone to get them off, detox at the very beginning. So these just don't exist. And even now, they tend not to exist out there in programs. If you think about two thirds of the programs, do not have any medications, and yet that's the standard way that people are thinking about getting people off drugs nowadays. I mean, that's a scandal. It's a total scandal. So I think that's really important. That's one of the sort of goals that I think we need to move toward, is making sure that that we have programs that actually work, and having medications there is one of them. There are, new programs that I hear about. Ibogaine is one that I've heard people talk about, that's got plant-based. I don't know that much about it. There's something called NET, NET, which is a new program that's being tested in Kentucky at present in a relatively small way. It evidently just got FDA approval. Is that the right word? FDA approval?
FDA, yeah.
FDA. It's a simple little thing where they put like this transmitter thing behind your ear, people, it's not a full part of, it's not a full program in that sense, but it helps cut the craving. And that's a critical piece of it for people who are addicted, right? And yet people don't want to hear about this because there's no kind of monetary incentive for doing it. If we could eliminate drugs by this small transmitter that you put behind your ears, or at least the craving for drugs, people say, well, where's the money? Where's the incentive to do that? How do we get people involved in that process? So, we've been our own worst enemy in a way, in ways where proven strategies are then not adopted, because people do have this, idea of the good guys and the bad guys. And people who are addicted have always been. I mean, that's stigma. I mean, that's another way.
Yeah.
Your way of describing that is really just another way of talking about stigma. And stigma, I talk about it in the book, is just being stark and raging. Still, the people who are addicted are, sort of have lower levels of, or the higher levels of stigma compared to anybody, even people who have severe mental health kinds of issues like schizophrenia and stuff. So, I think that we need to push more and address these, but there's so many other factors here, like the insurance system, and we need, insurance that will cover it for a sufficient number of time. We never had more than 30 days, you're 1 month and you're out, and you cannot get healthy in 30 days, but also insurance parity, right? That many insurance programs don't, even good insurance, even what I saw, Cadillac insurance that we had because we worked for the state of New Jersey, right? So we had really good insurance, but there were some charges that they would not pay for. And we had to pay out of pocket. And you were right. You mentioned earlier that people pay for these things out of pocket because families are desperate. They're desperate to save their loved ones. They think that, oh, if we do this, or if we do, or if, heaven forbid, like all of these things like codependency and hitting bottom and all those kinds of things. Oh, if we just let them, hit the bottom, then they'll learn, And it just doesn't work that way. That's
No,
kind of that's just
that's a myth.
inhumane,
Yeah.
uncompassionate. We need something that's more compassionate oriented, and that's kind of one of my themes in the book is to say, can't we move to something that is a more compassionate way of looking at it and meeting people where they are, even if they make small little goals? Let's celebrate those goals and then take it to the next step. And I've talked with family members. I've heard presentations by family members who go through this in their own house. And is it easy? You know, hell no, it's not easy, you know, because anybody who's lived with somebody who is addicted to drugs knows how insane it is. Being in the midst of that insanity, it's like, you know, as I said, a carousel ride from hell. And you, there just seems to be no way to get off of it once you get in that cycle. And parents have lived with it for, you know, 10, 20 years. You know, I don't see how any, we lived in it for 3 years and then plus the, you know, anorexia before that. But I don't know how people can do it. You know, it can destroy families.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, the stress involved is just can create a post-traumatic stress reaction in parents. And I've seen that over the years because I work with a lot of parents of young adults and teens that are dealing with whatever, you know, this issue with their children and their young adults. And I remember talking to somebody and their kid actually is starting to be kind of in recovery. And their kid called them to tell them something, some good news. And they had a panic attack when the phone rang because they thought that their kid was calling to say that they had been arrested or put in jail again, you know, or something like
that,
or worse. Right. So it's like,
wow. This,
you know, the parents, I feel like, need resources. They need support groups. There's a group called Parents of Addicted Loved Ones that I thought is pretty good, but it's mostly on the West Coast right now. That helps parents. And it's not just like Al-Anon where you're like, just let them do whatever. They'll figure it out. That's like the Al-Anon approach. It's like,
you know, my recommendation is I belong to this group called Moms for All Paths to Recovery. Oh, and nice. It is really fabulous because it's more of an educational group, not so much a, you know, like a group where people sit around talking as much about, I mean, people do raise issues that are going on in their families, but For most part, it's really an educational group. And every time I go on, I learn something new about. And I feel like I know a lot now, but I feel like all I did in my book was talk about, you know, give a kind of broad overview of how we as a society should be moving in this direction. But there's all of these people who understand about harm reduction who are on the ground doing this work that I admire so much. Parents who have lost their children, who have been trained to help other parents. You know, I personally, that would be too triggering for me, as they say. And so that would be just really, really hard. And so I feel like, but boy, chops to them. I mean, the fact that they do that is phenomenal because they lose their child and they want to take it and take that knowledge that they've learned to help other parents go through it. Because, you know, this is going to keep. The saddest thing to say is that this is going to keep going on. We're going to have another generation, at least, of people who are going to lose their kids in the same way that I did. And that's what I hope to provide is a description of that, you know, that says, here's a different way to think about it. Really, that's kind of what I want to get. The conventional ways are not working, and let's think about new ways to do it. And I like, you know, your way of kind of saying let's get rid of the status quo and rethink how do we go about doing this. You know, how can we be creative in doing this? And that's where we should be putting our money.
Oh, I agree completely.
And our thinking and our research.
Right. I mean, yeah, the research. The hard part about psychology is I think a lot of the practices that become popular are 15 or 20 years behind the research.
Yeah.
And I would say even worse for other industries. So in psychology, in the outpatient world, we're really emphasizing trauma-informed and meeting people where they're at and all that. The substance use research in the and motivation interviewing came out in 1980. Okay. A lot of the trauma-informed literature came out in the 90s, and we're just now getting more and more speed. So,
yeah.
So I think, you know, we have a long way to go as a society. And then, but I think the good news is in the meantime, you're writing these books, we're making these podcasts, and people can get the resources because in your book, you not only tell the story, but you talk about a lot of, you list resources, and I know you list them on your website for parents to get involved and don't, and to get as much information as possible. Yep. For their situation, to find out what interventions and treatments are going to work best, and for themselves also to get into possible support groups or treatments, you know, because it becomes a whole family issue, no matter if your child is 24, 25, or 10. It's a whole family issue, because when somebody's struggling like that, like, for instance, if a child has a disease like cancer, everyone, oh, let's rally around the child, yep. right? Well, right. Substance abuse is the same issue. It's just that we have been told to conceptualize of it differently, and the side effects are more frustrating to the families, because oftentimes we see the person as self-destructing, and yeah. technically they kind of are, because the substance has taken over, right? The addiction right. has taken over some of their behaviors. So I think for parent, I think you're doing a great job with the op-eds and getting out there and writing your book and talking about your story, which is very difficult to talk about. And I think it's been helpful for me to hear about what you went through, and the system that was not helpful, unfortunately, to you and your family.
No, especially, we didn't get a chance to talk much about it, but the medical system, I think, was particularly bad. And I'd love to, and I've actually been in conversations with a possibility of talking to, doctors, physicians, about how better to do their work, because, anytime Alex came up to a psychologist or psychiatrist or social worker, they were really bad. There's this one psychiatric hospital that he went to that within a week and a half, they had labeled him as a psychopath. I mean, sociopath and psychopath are not even a diagnosis in the DSM. And yet this doctor was doing that. And, you know, how dare he do this? Because he must understand about labeling, right? Labeling mm-hmm. theory, that you label someone, and this is, and he was, Alex was doing really well at this place. And then just this doctor and social worker started going kind of, he's saying the most incredibly obnoxious things about how, I don't think he's going to make it here. And he's a sociopath. And it was just like, this is really horrific. And as I try to say, right, at the end of the book, as I say, we all made mistakes, right? You know, we certainly made mistakes about listening to the current, theories of what one should do, and learned quickly from that, I hope. But I hope that hospitals and doctors groups actually read my book and say, look, this is what kind of an effect you had on this one young person and on his family. And what can we do to make it better? You know, this is really, really bad. I think that's what we have. That's part of education that we have to do moving forward, is to say, well, what do we do to make it better? Right.
I agree. I think there's a lot to be done and a lot of action needed, especially in the larger systems, the hospital mm-hmm. systems and the larger medical community as well. I agree completely. The answers are complicated, but with enough people understanding the issue, I think we can all do hopefully some part in changing this, and hopefully the right ears eventually hear this or the right eyes read it. But I think we can all do something by speaking up and becoming educated about it. I think that that's where the power lies in podcasting and writing books. So,
right.
Yeah. So yeah, where can people go ahead?
I was just going to say, podcasts didn't really exist just a short time
ago. That's true. This is a relatively new medium.
Yeah. And it's been very interesting to me to, to talk with a lot of podcasters, because, you know, you all ask very interesting questions, and it's helped me kind of hone my my argument and, you know, what is it that I'm trying to do. So it's been very useful for me so that when I go and I give presentations and stuff, I kind of know what the questions are. I said, oh, they're probably going to ask about this. And sometimes they do and sometimes they don't. You know, it's been very helpful for me personally, but also I think getting the word out there, you know, because I hope it means that more people read my book so that they will be in a position to know how at least one family went through it. You know, so to say, if it happened to this family, gosh, it could it happen to my family? And I say, yes, it could happen. But mostly I just want people to understand what it's like to go through this. That's really one of my number one goals is understanding what happens to a family when their loved one starts using substances. You know, what does it look like? It's not like it is in the movie, right? It's like maybe a very small piece of it, but you know, I just think that's something that is important for everybody to know. People who think it can't happen to them, yeah, it could happen to you. And I want to reach those people too. I want to reach the people every day when I sat down and wrote my book. I thought about people who were going to go through the same trauma that we went through, and I want them to know that that they're not alone and that I see them, right? I think that's important. But also, I don't want to just address those people. I want to address the people who think it can't happen to them, right? As I mentioned, so because I think everybody needs to understand it to know what could happen.
Yes, I agree completely. I appreciate your writing that, and I think people listening right now probably know someone in their life who has a concern about a family member, and that's a good opportunity to pick up your book from there. And you have a website as well.
Yes.
What is that for our listeners?
So the website is patroos.com, which is basically my name, Pat Roos, ROOS.com. And the reason I like to send people to my webpage is because I have resources in the book, but I have even more resources on my website, because certainly sites that have come out since I completed my book, anytime I see something that I think would be relevant, or I see a book, a new memoir that's come out, and I add that. You know, I just want to keep people up to date on the kind of good stuff that I see that exists out there, to let people read what they want. You know, sometimes things, you know, certain kinds of, sometimes people like the heavy research. Sometimes people like the memoirs. Sometimes people like the discussions of mental health kinds of issues. Sometimes people like to read about grief. And so all of those, I try to give resources in my webpage that do that. So I also have, you know, I have a media section where I put in things, people like you, and events that I'm doing. I did want to add to your list when you're talking about colleges. My husband and I were at Rutgers for 30 plus years before we retired, and Rutgers actually had the very first recovery house in the entire country, started by a friend of mine who just recently retired from her position. So Rutgers has done very, very well in terms of sort of collegiate caring. The guy who runs that program now is super. You know, I think that we need to tell places like that they are valued. I saw a table recently, a kind of figure that showed all the collegiate, you know, supports that existed out there. And you're right, it's like huge. There are huge numbers of them. But I said, you got to add Rutgers there, because Rutgers was the first. And recovery houses are critical.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Especially on campus, and the campus being aware of it. So.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So, well, thank you so much for coming on the podcast. It's been my pleasure to have you.
Thanks for inviting me. I really appreciated it. And it was a good conversation.
Absolutely.
And there you have it. This has been another episode of the Intentional Clinician Podcast. If you are enjoying the show, please leave us a rating on iTunes or share the show with people you know. I would surely appreciate it. As some of you know, I am passionate about preventing future violence in the United States. I have started a nonprofit with colleagues called the National Violence Prevention Hotline, which is a 501c3 organization. We are endeavoring to gain funding and collaborators and volunteers so that we can start a 24/7 hotline and chat line to reach potential perpetrators before they may act violently. It is a bold effort to curb violence and save innocent lives by working to connect with potential offenders while they are in the planning stages of violence, help to de-escalate them, and provide resources so that they can get appropriate professional help. The National Violence Prevention Hotline is looking to open up a conversation about violence in society, the causes, and the solutions. You can learn more by visiting our website at violencepreventionhotline.org. You can get involved by writing your congressperson from our website, sharing it with your network, or even donating to the cause. If you are looking for an EMDR, International Association Consultant, I am a consultant and I can help provide 20 hours that you need to become EMDRIA certified. Just check out the show notes and send me a message and see if we're a good fit to work together. If you are in need of counseling, do not hesitate to make an appointment with a local counselor in your area. You can also make an appointment with the excellent clinicians at Health for Life Counseling in Grand Rapids as part of the Trauma Informed Counseling Center of Grand Rapids by visiting www.healthforlifegr.com. And if you are in the state of Michigan, you can also schedule a telehealth appointment. The recording you just listened to consists of the personal opinions of Paul Krauss and his guest, and while these are based upon the literature they have read and the experience in their respective fields, the information on this podcast should not be viewed or thought of as the definitive opinion on any subject. Listening to this podcast is not a substitute for treatment. If you're in a crisis, please call 911 or the National Crisis Line at 988. Support your local bookstore by shopping at bookshop.org. That's www.bookshop.org. It donates a percentage of sales to local bookstores all across the United States, which I think gives character to our cities and a place to hang out and a place to explore. You can order from the comfort of your own home online while supporting businesses near you. If you are a therapist and you are not involved in your local counseling or therapist or social work organization, please get involved to at least pay dues so that we can have lobbyists help keep mental health care accessible at the government level, and also expanding into schools and other places that need it. And also, if you didn't know, counseling organizations and professional organizations are working to keep us from becoming gig workers for a lot of large corporations who are coming in and trying to buy up local counseling agencies or basically pay you what they pay for people to deliver food to your house. So, get involved. Until next time on The Intentional Clinician, I wish you all a safe and peaceful week.
Thank you.